Bless the Lord who forgiveth all our sins.
His mercy endureth forever.
Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires known, from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
You'll find on your insert this morning, Jubilate Deo. Let's remain standing as we sing. Father, whose blessed Son, Jesus Christ, came down from heaven to be the true bread which giveth life to the world. Evermore give us this bread, that he may live in us and we in him, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. Last week I announced to you the death of the sixth Bishop of Kentucky, Bishop David Reed. If you see the Courier Journal this weekend, there's an extensive biography of the bishop sits there. And it says that his funeral service will be on the 15th of April, which is more than a month away. So call that to your attention again. If you'll look at your bulletin for the announcements that are there, I call your attention to, we continue to have Tenebra on Tuesday evening. First week we had two people, the next week we had three people, the next week we had four people, so we kind of, and then we have one or two people who are watching that also on Zoom, so that that will be available for those who want to have a time of reflection and meditation during Lent on Tuesdays. We have sent out an email this week referencing a decision of the vestry that we will do a fellowship event on Palm Sunday. We'll meet at 8:30 for breakfast together, and continental breakfast, a simple breakfast, and then organize ourselves for the Palm Sunday procession, where we spend a little bit of time in the neighborhood here processing on the street before we come in for the Palm Sunday service. So put that on your calendar, and let us look forward both to the fellowship and to the solemnity of that very special day. The second of next month is Palm Sunday, and then of course Easter is the following Sunday after that. So we want you to mark all of those things on your schedule. I also call your attention to the Lenten schedule that we still have posted back in the back of the other things that we should know about as well. All right, are there any other announcements that need to be? Yes, please.
We have not done a good deep cleaning of the church for a number of years, so we are going to have a spring cleaning on Sunday, April the 1st, starting at 9 a.m. The vestry's asked us to get the church spruced up for Easter, so we will be cleaning the sanctuary. We'll also be working downstairs cleaning up our community area. So that is Saturday, April the 1st at 9 a.m. And there'll be light tasks, so anybody can be involved, and we truly appreciate your help with that. Barry will be sending out an email with more information on that this week.
Yeah, thank you for that. Ed, you have an announcement?
The good news continues. As of tomorrow at Flaget, visitors and staff will no longer be under a mask mandate. First time in 3 years, and we're very happy to announce that.
If there are no other announcements, we welcome our guests who are visiting with us from Wisconsin this morning. Thank you for choosing to worship with us here today. Our service continues now with the readings from the Word of God.
Our first reading this morning is from 1 Samuel chapter 16. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you grieve over Saul? I have rejected him from being king over Israel. Fill your horn with oil and set out. I will send you to Jesse, the Bethlehemite, for I have provided for myself a king among his sons." Samuel said, "How can I go? If Saul hears of it, he will kill me." And the Lord said, "Take a heifer with you and say, 'I have come to sacrifice to the Lord.' Invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what you shall do, and you shall anoint for me the one whom I named you." Samuel did what the Lord commanded and came to Bethlehem. The elders of the city came to meet him, trembling, and said, "Do you come peaceably?" He said, "Peaceably. I come to sacrifice to the Lord. Sanctify yourselves and come with me to the sacrifice." And he sanctified Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. When they came, he looked on Eliab and thought, "Surely the Lord's anointed is now before the Lord." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord does not see as mortals see. They look on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." Then Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. He said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Then Jesse made Shammah pass by, and he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel, and Samuel said to Jesse, "The Lord has not chosen any of these." Samuel said to Jesse, "Are all your sons here?" And he said, "There remains yet the youngest, but he is keeping the sheep." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Send and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes here." He sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy and had beautiful eyes and was handsome. The Lord said, "Rise and anoint him, for this is the one." Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers, and the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. Samuel then set out and went to Ramah. This is the word of the Lord. Our psalm this morning is Psalm 122. Please read responsively at the verse. I was glad when they said to me, "Let us go to the house of the Lord." Jerusalem is built as a city that is a unity with itself. For there are thrones of judgment, the thrones of the house of David.
Pray for the peace of Jerusalem, that they may prosper
above. Peace be within your walls and quietness within your towers.
For my brethren and your sake, I pray for prosperity.
Because of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek to do you good. Our second reading this morning is from Ephesians chapter 5. Once you were darkness, but now in the Lord you are light. Live as children of light, for the fruit of the light is found in all that is good and right and true. Try to find out what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them. For it is shameful even to mention what such people do secretly, but everything exposed by the light becomes visible, for everything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it says, "Sleeper, awake, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Now let us stand for our hymn before the gospel rejoices.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you.
As he walked along, Jesus saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" Jesus answered, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's works might be revealed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." When he had said this, he spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him, "Go, wash in the pool of Siloam," which means sent. Then he went and washed and came back, able to see. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar began to ask, "Is this not the man who used to sit and beg?" Some were saying, "It is he." Others were saying, "No, but it is someone like him." He kept saying, "I am the man." But they kept asking him, "Then how were your eyes opened?" He answered, "The man called Jesus made mud, spread it on my eyes, and said to me, 'Go to Siloam and wash.' Then I went and washed and received my sight." They said to him, "Where is he?" He said, "I do not know." They brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Now it was a Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. Then the Pharisees also began to ask him how he'd received his sight. He said to them, "He put mud on my eyes, then I washed, and now I see." Some of the Pharisees says, "This man is not from God, for he does not observe the Sabbath." But others said, "How can a man who is a sinner perform such signs?" And they were divided. So they said again to the blind man, "What do you say about him? It was your eyes he opened." He said, "He is a prophet." The Jews did not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight until they called the parents of the man who had received his sight and asked them, "Is this your son who you say was born blind? How then does he now see?" His parents answered, "We know that this is our son and that he was born blind, but we do not know how it is that now he sees, nor do we know who opened his eyes. Ask him, he is of age, he will speak for himself." His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews, for the Jews had already agreed that anyone who confessed Jesus to be the Messiah would be put out of the synagogue. Therefore, his parents said, "He is of age, ask him." So for the second time, they called the man who had been blind, and they said to him, "Give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner." He answered them, "I do not know whether he is a sinner. One thing I do know, though, that I was blind, now I see." They said to him, "What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?" He answered them, "I've told you already, and you would not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you also want to become his disciples?" Then they reviled him, saying, "You are his disciple, but we are disciples of Moses. We know that God has spoken to Moses, but as for this man, we do not know where he comes from." The man answered, "Here is an astonishing thing. You do not know where he comes from, and yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but he does listen to one who worships him and obeys his will. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a person born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing." They answered him, "You were born entirely in sins, and you are trying to teach us." And they drove him out. Jesus heard that they had driven him out, and when he found him, he said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" He answered, "And who is he, sir? Tell me so that I may believe in him." Jesus said to him, "You've seen him, and the one speaking with you is he." He said, "Lord, I believe." And he worshiped him. Jesus said, "I came into this world for judgment, so that those who do not may see, and those who do see may become blind." Some of the Pharisees near him heard this, and they said to him, "Surely we are not blind, are we?" Jesus said to him, "If you were blind, you would not have sin. But now that you say we see, your sin remains." This is the good news, the gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to thee, O Christ. The Lord grant his blessing. The Lord be in my heart and on my lips, that I may worthily and fittingly proclaim his holy gospel in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Please be seated. Today is the mid-Lent Sunday, the midpoint in the season of Lent. Today is called Rejoice Sunday. from the first words of the traditional introit verse at the beginning of the service, "Rejoice, O Jerusalem, come together all you who love her. Rejoice with joy, you have been in sorrow." From Isaiah 66:10. The collect at the beginning of our service is included as a reference to the gospel lesson that had long been associated with this day. That gospel account was the story of the feeding of the multitude, which is one of the seven signs in the Gospel of John, demonstrating the divinity of Jesus. The reference to bread in the wilderness has given this Sunday also the name Refreshment Sunday. Today's gospel, the healing of the man born blind, is another of the seven signs. And the gospel selection next Sunday, too, will be another of the seven signs. The original gospel account for the fourth Sunday in Lent this Sunday was associated with the practice of the Pope distributing bread on this day to the poor people of Rome. The other thing the Pope did on the fourth Sunday in Lent was to take up a special offering for the Mother Diocese of Jerusalem. The epistle lesson was from Galatians, which compares the earthly Jerusalem to the heavenly Jerusalem. It says, "Jerusalem, which now is in bondage with her children. But Jerusalem, which is above, is free, which is the mother of us all." Thus, this Sunday became also known as Mothering Sunday. The English modified the custom to remember the mother church of their own diocese in England and to do something nice for one's own mother. And that is still the popular practice in England today. Here in America, we celebrate Mother's Day in May. We no longer also take up a collection for Jerusalem on this Sunday. But Anglicans around the world now designate the Good Friday offering for the province of Jerusalem in the Middle East. And the province consists of three dioceses. The Diocese of Jerusalem, which includes Israel, Palestinian territories, Jordan, Syria, and Lebanon. And the Diocese of Cyprus and the Gulf, which includes Cyprus, the Arabian Peninsula, and Iraq. And the Diocese of Iran. Christians are a small minority in the region of the province of Jerusalem and the Middle East, and their resources to sustain themselves are limited. They are like lights in the darkness, the faithful witnesses in the land of our Savior's birth, in the city of his death and resurrection. Also in the lands of the patriarch Abraham's birth and his death, and in the lands of the exile of Israel as well. If we all share but just a little of what we have, we can help them a lot. A little bit of help can go a long way. The whole region of Jerusalem in the Middle East today is beset with unrest and conflict. Psalm 122 bids us pray for the peace of Jerusalem. But the present day Jerusalem knows no lasting peace. The peace we seek, for which we long, is the peace of that other Jerusalem. The heavenly Jerusalem, which is above. And there will be a time of rejoicing. An English bard with the initials FBP, circa the 16th century, penned these words, "O Mother dear Jerusalem, when shall I come to thee? When shall my sorrows have an end? Thy joys, when shall I see? Jerusalem, Jerusalem, God grant that I may see thine endless joy and of the same partaker ever be. When shall these eyes thy heaven-built walls and pearly gates behold? Thy bulwarks with salvation strong and streets of shining gold. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, God grant that I may see thine endless joy and of the same partaker ever be. Thy saints are crowned with glory great. They see God face to face. They triumph still. They still rejoice. Most happy is their case. There David stands with harp in hand as master of the choir. 10,000 times that man were blessed who might this music hear. Our Lady sings Magnificat with tunes surpassing sweet, and old Simeon and Zachary their canticles repeat. There Magdalene hath left her moan and cheerfully doth sing with blessed saints whose harmony in every street doth ring. Apostles, martyrs, prophets, there around my Savior stand, and all I love in Christ below will join the glorious band. O Christ, do thou my soul prepare for that bright home of love, that I may see thee and adore with all thy saints above. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, God grant that I may see thine endless joy and of the same partaker ever be. Now let us look at the scripture lessons that we have heard today. In Paul's epistle to the Ephesians, we heard, once you were in darkness, but now in the Lord, you are light. Live as children of light. Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness. What are the unfruitful works of darkness? We confess so many of them. Our unfaithfulness, arrogance, hypocrisy, self-indulgent appetites and ways, exploitation, hostility, envy, dishonesty, negligence, blindness to human need and suffering, indifference to injustice and cruelty, false judgments, uncharitable thoughts and deeds, disrespect, prejudice, contempt, deprivation, waste, pollution, destruction of our environment, and the ravages of war. God be merciful and forgive us, sinners. In the gospel, we heard Jesus declare, I am the light of the world. Light is the sign of the divinity of Christ. In this gospel account, Jesus restored sight to the blind. The man who was healed said, one thing I know, I was blind, but now I see. But in the hardness of our hearts, the Pharisees who observed this did not rejoice. They branded Jesus a sinner for healing on the Sabbath. The self-righteous religious had their eyes closed to goodness and right. Their vision was blinded by their misguided doctrinaire views. An American hymn writer, Philip P. Bliss, Methodist Congregationalist, wrote in 1875, "The light of the world is Jesus." The whole world was lost in darkness of sin. The light of the world is Jesus. Like sunshine at noonday, his glory shone in. The light of the world is Jesus. Come to the light, 'tis shining for thee. Sweetly the light has dawned upon me. Once I was blind, but now I can see. The light of the world is Jesus. No darkness have we who in Jesus abide. The light of the world is Jesus. We walk in the light when we follow our guide. The light of the world is Jesus. Ye dwellers in darkness with sin blinded eyes, the light of the world is Jesus. Go wash at his bidding, and light will arise. The light of the world is Jesus. No need of the sunlight in heaven, we're told. The light of the world is Jesus. The Lamb is the light in the city of gold. The light of the world is Jesus. Come to the light, to shining for thee. Sweetly the light has dawned upon me. Once I was blind, but now I can see. The light of the world is Jesus. What a remarkable affirmation that is. The light of the world is Jesus. What a remarkable claim Jesus made. I am the light of the world. The opening verses of the Bible, the first words of the Creator are, "Let there be light." The prologue of the Gospel of John declares, "The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it." So, let us rejoice and be glad that the light of the world has shined upon us. As the children of light, as the disciples of Jesus Christ, let us expose the works of darkness. Let us rejoice in the good news that our sins have been forgiven. Let us follow Jesus' example to alleviate human suffering and wrong. Let our eyes be open to every opportunity to serve and love others as Jesus loves us. Let your light shine before others, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. And now unto the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only wise God, be honor and glory forever and ever. To him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. Amen. The Apostles' Creed is found on page 326 in the Book of Common Prayer. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten and not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Our service continues with the prayers found on page 383 in the Book of Common Prayer.
With all our heart and with all our mind, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above, for the loving kindness of God, and for the salvation of our souls, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the world, for the welfare of the Holy Church of God, and for the unity of all peoples, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our bishop, and for all the clergy and people, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our president, for the leaders of the nations, and for all in authority, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this city, for every city and community, and for those who live in them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For seasonable weather, and for an abundance of the fruits of the earth, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the good earth which God has given us, and for the wisdom and will to conserve it, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who travel on land, on water, or in the air, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the aged and infirm, for the widowed and orphans, and for the sick and the suffering, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the poor and the oppressed, for the unemployed and the destitute, for prisoners and captives, and for all who remember and care for them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have died in the hope of the resurrection, and for all the departed, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For deliverance from all danger, violence, oppression, and degradation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the absolution and remission of our sins and offenses, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That we may end our lives in faith and hope, without suffering and without reproach, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Defend us, deliver us, and in thy compassion protect us, O Lord, by thy grace.
Lord, have mercy.
In the communion of the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our God.
To thee, O Lord, our God.
Merciful God, who did send thy Son, the light of the world, to open the eyes of the blind, bring light into the darkness of our hearts, that we may see clearly and declare that by thy grace our infirmities are healed. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to thy apostles, peace I give to you, My own peace I leave with you. Regard not our sins, but the faith of thy church, and give to us the peace and unity of that heavenly city, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit thou dost live and reign now and forever. Amen. God grant to the living grace, to the departed rest, to the church, the nation, and all the world peace and concord, and to us and all thy servants eternal life in thy heavenly kingdom. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Ye who do truly and earnestly repent you of your sins, and are in love and charity with your neighbors, and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God, and walking henceforth in his holy ways, now draw near with faith, and make your humble confession to Almighty God, devoutly kneeling or sitting as you are able.
God, our Heavenly Father, who with great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us stand well. Hear the word of God to all who truly turn to him. Come unto me, all ye that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, to the end that all that believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. This is a true saying and worthy of all men to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. And he is the perfect offering for our sins, and not for ours only, but for the sins of the whole world. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself as an offering and sacrifice for sins. Let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. Let us with gladness present the offerings and oblations of our life and labor unto the Lord.
Amen.
the humble offering of our substance and of ourselves, that what we present upon thy altar may be used to thy glory, for the edifying of the body of Christ, for the work of the ministry, for the welfare of the saints, for the establishment of thy truth and virtue, for the sake and by the grace of Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Ghost, one God, world without end.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is meet and right so to do.
It is right. It is very meet and right and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, almighty everlasting God, who didst bid thy faithful people cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the paschal feast, that fervent in prayer and works of mercy and renewed by thy word and sacraments, they may come to the fullness of grace which thou hast prepared for those who love thee. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, Holy, 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 Holy Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of thy glory. Glory be to thee, O Lord most high. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna. All glory be to thee, almighty God, our heavenly Father, for that thou, thy tender mercy, didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made thereby his one oblation of himself once offered, a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute and in his holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memory of that his precious death and sacrifice until his coming again. For in the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as you shall drink it, in remembrance of me. Wherefore, Lord and Heavenly Father, according to the institution of thy dearly beloved Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, we, thy humble servants, who celebrate and make here before thy divine majesty, with these thy holy gifts, which we now offer unto thee, the memorial thy Son hath commanded us to make, having in remembrance his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, rendering unto thee most hearty thanks for the innumerable benefits procured unto us by the Son. And we most humbly beseech thee, O merciful Father, to hear us, to thy almighty goodness vouchsafe to bless and sanctify with thy word and Holy Spirit these thy gifts and creatures of bread and wine, that we, receiving them according to thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. And we earnestly desire thy fatherly goodness mercifully to extend accept. This our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Most humbly beseeching thee to grant that by the merits and death of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto thee. Humbly beseeching thee that we and all others who shall be partakers of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ. Be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction and make one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him. And although we are unworthy through our manifold sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses through Jesus Christ, our Lord, by whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end.
Amen. Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you. Feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
feed on him and die on him. Jesus gives the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which is given for us. Preserve thy body and soul in the last system of so much. Make it eat this in remembrance of Christ, died for thee, and feed on him and thy heart.
Works that thou prepared for us to walk in.
Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end.
Amen.
Our closing hymn is 344, Lord, dismiss us with thy blessing. Worthy of